And Shahzad bhai, now we are playing ICI motto song. I request all to put their right hand on their heart.
यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति कामं 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 कामवशो पुरुषो निर्विमाणः निर्विमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रदब्रह्म
Good evening, friends. Respected chairman of Ahmedabad branch, CA Fanil Shah, creator of this series and Vikasa chairperson, CA Choksi, Dr. Today's learned faculty, CA Amisha Vora, coordinator of this session, CA Hema Shah. Friends, it gives us immense pleasure that Ahmedabad branch won Best Branch Award and Best Vikasa Awards. So congratulations to both our chairman CA Fanil Shah and chairperson Dr. CA Anjali Choksi. It's a great moment post COVID that we are getting to be glad to cherish the moment what we did in the last couple of months, I can say physically and virtually what we did during the COVID times. As we all on that day of lockdown, seen stock market how it was, and now we are observing V curve, so called by the economist, and definitely your investments are being touched great heights as the Sensex touch something more than 51,000. We are not able to know, or we are not able to predict even which height it's going to reach and how we can earn out of this, because we must have an alternative medium of earning. So how we can go for a portfolio management or a financial consultancy, and we have to evolve with new opportunities as well. Agar COVID ke pehle koi aur business kar raha tha, aur COVID ke baad mein if they have thought of something else, then definitely friends, their turnover will be there, or they are not going to rise. And that's how we also as a chartered accountant should think in years to come. With these words, I welcome all the participants and today's learned faculties, and request Anjali ma'am to unmute herself and take it forward. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary C.A. Bhishan Shah, for the first news. We all are at Delhi to receive the award for the Vikasa as well as the best branch of Ahmedabad. And the esteem, and I'm glad that today's faculty is among us, CA Amisha Vora, and especially women. So my heartfelt warm welcome to you. The coordinator for today's series, CA Hema Shah, CA Fanil Shah, the chairman in absentia, and all my dear participants. I welcome you to what I hope what is going to be one of the most interesting series. Risk hai to ishq hai, and everybody in the COVID must have watched this series. And we Gujaratis, being the capitalists, love taking huge risk, whether it's Adani Shares or Zydus Group or GNFC, GMDC. Gujarat has always been a sizable presence and control on the Indian stock market. Taking this into consideration, the series is designed, of course, Madam had been there right from the beginning in designing this series. The whole series, we have got the expert faculty from Prabhudas Leeladhar. So thank you once again, ma'am, for this initiative. It was her idea that let's have this beautiful series. So once again, thank you so much, ma'am. We have taken right from basics of investment till going depth of derivatives, and the last session would be option trading strategies. And we have got an overwhelming response from Ahmedabad branch. So please be free if you want many more sessions in this, the kind of topics you are looking for, please contact us or any of the coordinators of this series. I once again welcome you all. The madam will deliver the session, and then in last 15-20 minutes, we can have a Q&A. So you can post your questions on the session box. And now without taking much time, and we are curious to listen to ma'am, I would request CA Hema Shah, the moderator for this series, to take the session ahead. Thank you. And once again, I welcome all of you on bottom of my heart for giving me overwhelming response for this series. Thank you so much.
Thanks, CA Anjali Choksi, CA Bhishan Shah, the secretary, and my very many congratulations to you all, the most energetic and enthusiastic team, to be getting the best branch award Pan India and the best Vikasa branch award. And carrying forward this series, I would like to start with introducing our learned faculty for the day. She is a chartered accountant who started her career as an analyst with GM Financial. She is also the joint MD and key shareholder of Prabhudas Leeladhar. She regularly features on leading business channels like CNBC, ET Now, and her views and insights are very much sought after. She joined on Prabhudas Leeladhar in the year 2000, and over two decades, she has actually performed her role as a partner in nation building, wherein she has grown this group's institutional business 36-fold in 6 years. In 2003, in 2005, getting good appreciation in stocks. She even spearheaded the corporate advisory business, which helped corporates raise $1.8 billion during 2005-08. And she has launched, under her leadership, the NBFC business and investment banking business. Later on, as the head of the retail division, she has strengthened the Prabhudas Leeladhar's presence in key markets and has also been an innovator through a number of innovative products that she has launched. Not to cut her introduction short, I mean, it is fully loaded and you all will be really surprised. I mean, you know, a great inspiration in the true sense, who has won a number of awards, accolades and recognition over her long career. She has been adjudged as the best salesperson of the year by Asia Money for 3 consecutive years, the rising star by Business Today, being one of the 10 most powerful women, the outstanding contributor to the equity markets by Zee Business Market Analyst in 2014, the Woman Entrepreneur of the Year Award by Bharat Nirma 2017, one of Asia's most admired business leaders at the Asia Pacific Leadership Conclave in Singapore by the White Page International, the Power Women 2018 Award by the Jito Foundation, Gem of India Award from All India Achiever Conference 2018, Iconic Inspirational Woman of Navbharat by Navbharat Group 2018, Business Woman Excellence of Indian Business Woman of the Year Award by the Indian Business Woman Conference 2019, Woman Empowerment Principles Leadership Award 2019-20 by Asia One, and United Nations Global Compact UAE. The top 100 women in finance 2020 by Association of International Wealth Management of India. Apart from this, she is also supporting social causes and has been a full-time long supporter of Happy Home Orphanage in Mumbai and a regular contributor to the Vashres across the country. So ma'am, I would just like to club up your so many achievements. Women like shopping. You like shopping for, I mean, you like, you know, going after awards. And the long list says that over a long spanning decade. So So not wasting much time, we are very much eager to hear from you everything about your journey and the markets. Over to you, ma'am.
Ma'am, kindly unmute yourself. And yes, during your session, we would like to have some more scripts from you so we can also get awards from the stock market. And I'm very much sure that awards cannot be purchased or procured or shopped. For that, you have done excellent work for the nation, for the community. So, ma'am, congratulations, and we are obliged to have you here.
Thank you so much. And first and foremost, I would like to congratulate you both, the winning team, who has brought and who has won the Best Branch Award. And frankly, from the enthusiasm with which Anjali spoke to me, and today I heard you, I'm very sure that you are the deserving team to win this award. Heartiest congratulations. I also welcome all my fellow chartered accountants whom I'm very, very happy to associate after, I think, a good gap. And I also want to, before I go over to my presentation, CA Hema Shah mentioned about shopping, whether I'm fond of shopping. And, you know, being a woman, and working throughout, there were very critical moments in my career also when my child was very young and I had to make choice between continuing my career where I used to travel like 15 days in a month or 20 days in a month and balancing with my child's brought up education, etc. And I used to just tell myself, you know, if you don't be steady and not go through this, because more than anything, it is the emotional stress that it brings when you have to leave your child. And if you don't do this, you also might be like others, picking up and shopping either Bangan or Alu instead of picking up Hindustan Lever or Reliance. So stay put and go through. And fortunately, today, my son is also a CA, CFA, and an MSc in Business Excellence. And so one of the biggest award of my journey is, of course, my son's achievement. Now, not taking little more any longer, I will take you all through a presentation because I thought that this is the community of CA. Quite a few things you all understand. But I would like to take you all through as to why markets are so buoyant, despite the fact that businesses were impacted. And how do we see things going forward? Why? Give me a second to screen share. And one important thing to know about the markets is that markets have two key pillars for its run or ride either side. One, as we call it, the liquidity pillar or the technicals, demand supply, and the other, the core or business profits earnings. So sometimes when business profits and earnings don't look so charming in short term and still markets are moving, then it is the liquidity or technicals part which could be much stronger than the normal. And typically, in last few crises globally, the new economics has been proven that in times of crisis, when you put more than sufficient money into system, the uncertainty settles down. Asset prices to start with starts moving up, and ultimately it also percolates down into a larger confidence for consumers to buy and in turn manufacturers to put more facility. So to link this thing, which I was trying to explain in the current context, what has really happened, as we all know, post-COVID, the first time ever the world was shutting down. So of course, there was no GDP, there was no earnings, there was no circulation, and there was no logical fundamental part for markets to move up. Now to tide over, quite a few of you all might know, the US Fed came up. Not only it came up, like for example, last crisis, over 18 months, they had supplied $2 trillion extra dollars to global economy, particularly in US. But money travels everywhere. This time, in a span of just about 32 days, they committed $8 trillion. So the crisis was much larger. The response was unprecedented. And as that money started going into the hands of people, A, who were not having immediate work or job. So the Robin Hood culture has come up wherein people trade. But beyond that, the money has also found its place in people's spending and asset classes and asset prices rising. We are also one of the critical participants of this global trend which has emerged post-COVID, and how we, apart from this biggest factor for market ride, which is the technicals or liquidity, have been doing as economy is something that I will try to take you all through. So as you all can see, there were many crises markets have seen. And after each crisis, the broad trend of the markets have been one of upwards. And for all of you, this is a very important lesson to know, because, you know, while Brijesh Bhai said that all of us should have a second way of earning or avenue of earning, I would say that, you know, markets are the place where you put your savings and start your journey of wealth creation. It's only through discipline, systematic, whatever you call, investments into markets that for people like you and me, wealth is created. Otherwise, wealth is created for entrepreneurs when their businesses grow, their equity valuation of their businesses grow. That's how the wealth is created. But for all of us, the wealth creation happens by becoming partner in those businesses which are doing well. And this chart shows that come what may, whatever the crisis, the market in a developing economy like us is one of upward. The key reasons is what I said, that this excess liquid, not excess, but the liquidity which Fed and other central banks created at some point started entering financial markets. And as you can see, in 2020, we got record FII inflows of almost 172,000 crores. And that is one of the key direct contributor to a stupendous rise in markets because of the demand supply. And at the same time, if you can see the little dark blue square, which shows that 36,000 crores from all across domestic mutual funds and insurance companies were taken away by you and me, who unlocked their investments, either with fear or genuinely because other avenues of income were less, so people had to redeem. The same trend is continuing in the current year, first 1 month or few weeks, and the inflow has been very large. Now, apart from this technical factor, how is the economy really shaping up? So all the high frequency economic indicators have, despite all the possible debates which were happening, fortunately for India, have shown a V-shaped recovery. And one of the key demonstrator of that is, of course, our GST collection, which is on the top of all the production and services that we offer as a country. The trend has been phenomenally good. We believe that all throughout this COVID crisis, when manufacturing was impacted, exports were impacted, our rural economy gave India a lot of support. Because for the last 2 to 3 years, MSPs have been rising, crops were good, and the penetration of financial services in many ways was also very good. So that rural economy was very stable. It continued to not get as much impacted by COVID and shutdowns. Happened, the pent-up demand hugely started from the rural and semi-urban side. Urban incomes were impacted. And because that gave a very good base, production was less, the out-of-stock situations happened. Personal schemes, all this put together, we are seeing huge and strong GST collection. Of course, railway freight tonnage, which is one of the other indicators, is also showing very good growth, as you all can very clearly see. And this is all YOY growth. So we are not only talking about month over month growth, this is as compared to even last year's October, November, December, we are so much positive. This is electricity generation, once again showing one of the best ever growth trend. There were no problem as such in 18 and 19, but on those bases, we are showing such very good growth. Steel consumption in November, of course, is also showing a 23% growth. There is definitely pent up in terms of auto consumption, in terms of white goods consumption, which is where also steel goes. Pent up demand is also resulting into high steel consumption. Plus, November was the festive month. We are also seeing diesel consumption getting impacted a bit because, as we all know, the key mobility till November was impacted, whether it is across states, within states like Maharashtra, we were all reluctant to travel, any modes. This is also one more, which is peak power. Just 1 second. Can you just remove this bar? So, one more indicator is that all the fast-moving consumer goods, their sales growth also is very positive. And, you know, we keep saying whether V-shape and this shape, but as you see, all the charts are actually showing a V-shape recovery. So, this is also one of the very important things to keep in mind, the redemption, but the deposit growth is showing a steady trend while the credit growth in the economy is yet to pick up. And that continues to show a good amount of weakness. Some of the important reasons also being that still, while retail is continuing to grow in the credit side, the industry is still not taking more credit. And large part of the credit growth used to also be contributed by either telecom or oil and gas. And both of them, because of low working capital requirement, because of low oil prices, are not consuming a lot of working capital, apart from the fact that no new large projects and capex cycle have yet started in India. This is also about the breakup of IIP. I may not take in full detail. It is just tells that the recovery process is across. The other important fact always to look at while assessing the market's journey is the fact that where is inflation going? And as most of you would know, that inflation is a key determinant typically of the interest rate outlook. Inflation and interest rate put together decide the total demand in any economy. So a watchful eye on inflation is always a must to know how the liquidity and interest rate outlook will remain. Because of the production cutdowns and the fact that there were disruptions in rural economy only for connecting the supplies, the vegetable prices and all key other prices were disturbed, and we could see even food inflation rising hugely to 11%, CPI rising also, except that core inflation trend was pretty steady. And as we move forward and the unlocking started happening, food inflation has settled down. Also, the CPI has been also showing a trend of reversing. And these two are reasonably very positive sign. We don't expect RBI to, but it should not in a hurry to counter inflation increase the interest rate, which can harm the overall demand. So even this indicator as of now is comfortable. This is about the trade deficit. Now, very important part is that post the COVID, not only India, what has happened to world growth projections? And if you see that old projections for 21 and new projections for 21. Across the world, for US, and particularly for India, there is huge growth in new projections. Your area continues to remain under stress, but most of the other parts are showing better projections than before. Now, apart from this general indicators post-COVID, which have given good support to the overall economic activity, we as a house believe that there is a super cycle of growth beginning for India. And as most of you know, that in the last 5 years, we have been going from one reforms to the other. Some which impacted businesses hugely, some which did not impact business, but created a ground for a very good growth in future. So what are those reforms which happened? For example, rural and other accounts were connected, which helped us achieve direct benefit transfer, DBT as we call. And in turn, all the kind of subsidies or help started reaching the last mile, and which helps in turn consumption, not hoarding, and also all the excesses which were going got curtailed. So ability to meet more last mile increased with DBT. It didn't disturb the business, but it created a ground for more demand and cost-effective demand. Similarly, the rollouts of 4G and 3G helped substantially because the reach overall of Digital India increased massively. Other reforms which disturbed the business, one of them, of course, was demonetization. But that brought more focus on formal economy. So in medium term, as expected, informal economy to formal economy, the transition has started. Other reform which disturbed the business, of course, good for long term, but disturbed the business was GST. There was a month particularly when businesses suffered because of stocking, destocking calculations. And then also the rise was little, the normalization was little challenging. Having done all that, plus the RERA, and above all, the cleanup in banks. I think that is one of the biggest reform which has happened in India, which curtailed India's growth in last 5 years hugely, because that easy money to any entrepreneur Even if 50% was coming into CapEx, that stopped. And all the banks were busy cleaning up their books, which is one of the toughest decisions to take. But we as a country took that decision. And now as we see, all the huge accounts, which were totaling to almost 6 lakh crores, either are sorted out by selling or through NCLT. And we can see that major part of the corporate restructuring with reflecting in banks' books is behind us. COVID provided one more opportunity with the fear that the retail NPS banks raise new capital and now they are ready to support the new growth super cycle. We feel one of the key contributors to this super cycle will be housing construction and residential real estate. In very nutshell, I'll tell you why. Because over the last 10 years, on one hand, real estate prices were coming down. The average Indian salary or income was moving up, if nothing, at the rate of inflation. These two as a combination improves the affordability of anybody to buy a house. Like earlier, it used to be 15 to 18 years salary in which individual could buy a house. Now it has come down to between 5 and 7 years. So one of the world standards in which the affordability index has come. And above all, the interest rate on housing finance is the lowest in a decade or more. Last but not the least, the work from home culture has finally pushed the hesitant buyer to take the decision, because children need separate room for school. Husband, of course, needs a separate room for office. Parents needs some peaceful area. Otherwise, they will be stuck to see even the TV. And this has pushed the final pressure for the buyer to act. We also say, of course, the reduction in stamp duty has helped. But this is now a cycle which has turned. And as we say, the highest multiplier impact in an economy is in real estate. So when US wanted to come out, they supported in every which way the housing construction, because so many people and so many products get involved in making the houses, in turn so many industries benefiting. So that will be one of the biggest change factor, we think, which will contribute to an Indian economy over a longish period. The infrastructure pushed by government of India used to be there, but taken a very bold approach, as what is evident from the fiscal deficit. We call it a 360 degree change in government's approach and commitment to growth, because and the way it has been executed till now is also very good. That pre-budget, they created the whole presentation comparing why this fiscal deficit should not be a key worry in medium term for rating agencies. And during budget, they also made a very important point that this 6.8% fiscal deficit for FY22 is not going to come back to 3% pre-COVID levels in a hurry. We are committed to growth and slightly more investments in economy till 25-26. They said 4.5% fiscal deficit till 25-26. Now that is a big commitment for investments and economy. Higher rural income, which has been continuing, and as and when the agri reforms unlock, that will also contribute substantially. Strong demand for Indian IT services. Now, in a very nutshell, I'll say that globally, some of the largest retailers to banks realized that in terms of their readiness for digital economy, they still rank between 16-18%, not even 30-40% as an organization. So they are all in a great hurry to upgrade their digitization, which is what is benefiting all the Indian IT services companies. Of course, Make in India push finally seems to be for this, and PLI is a very smart move by government, and that I think will bring a lot of benefit. Apart from the fact that globally there had been a lot of anger against the culprit who brought COVID. So a second base will be created. Up till now, Vietnam has benefited most, but we believe India also will have its few due share. So now some of these now is showing the points which I talked about. I may keep it for a few seconds. This is about affordability index. This is how the launches and sales are picking up. So is what we say, the rest of the demand will now pick up. So most B2C categories like wires, switch gears, fans, lighting, kitchen appliances, and white goods have started reporting stupendous growth. Building material sales are also at all-time high growth. And we expect the trend of growth to improve substantially. So just to bind the two together, I'll take just one point here, that when we say that government, focus on infrastructure, then it reflects in L&T bagging 30%, 36% increase in order inflow in Q3. I quickly summed up all this so that I also get chance to wind up my presentation in time. This is talking about how the major crop prices have been firmed and vegetable prices have softened. Correct. Last point I will just take up, which I touched, but I'll take up, that we look at exports as big global opportunity, as we call it, China plus one strategy, which is unfolding globally. And within auto component, which is a $550 billion industry in China, and we are at just $50 billion. So there is huge scope for us over a period of time to keep growing. And this additional push on infrastructure, which is what will make Indian industry competitive, apart from the fact that to start with, they need PLI, that additional little margin to compete globally. But otherwise, your time to port, your time to factory, and rest of the things decide your infrastructure, decides your competitiveness of the industry, which is what we are creating. Not to forget, pharma is also in a positive cycle of its own. And chemical, which is where China is getting slightly debased and a lot of demand is coming to India. This is about banking as a sector and how this can help their liquidity coverage ratio as well as provision coverage can help capital. Because bank, the extent of what capital they have is a multiplier to their capital. So capital raised by banks in during COVID will now make them very ready for growth and support the economy. I will now touch upon a slightly more technical thing here. We say market bahu vadhi gayu and market bahu ghati gayu. So how do we really look at it? So Nifty is a 1 year forward PE. So we take out all Nifty companies' free float earnings. And then based on Nifty levels, we take the, so Nifty 1 year forward PE is currently at 25% premium to its 10-year average. Now, there are two factors to be kept in mind while this premium is looked at. Whenever the PE goes inverse to bond yield, when the bond yield or interest rates comes down, the PE goes up. Because for the same earning, the earnings yield bond yield ratio changes. So with this global liquidity and low bond prices, or rather negative bond yields, a premium to PE is bound to be there. And also the markets are at just 5% below 10-year high multiple. In India, from 2013-14, the Nifty growth was completely curtailed because of the cleanup in banking and its impact on banking profits, plus its impact on capex cycle and resultant Indian economy growth. So there are two factors. The EPS was also very low till last, in last 10 year, the EPS growth. The other way to look at it is that MSCI India premium to MSCI. MSCI is Morgan Stanley index, which is all the Asian economies, continues to go down given firm global markets. That means India alone is not doing so well. So many Asian economies, emerging economies are doing well, that when we compare this to emerging economies and their multiples, we are not out of place as yet in terms of our valuation. This is, of course, a quick trend which shows that how the Nifty EPS projections are going up, inching up quarter over quarter. What analysts are compelled to do? Analysts have to increase their earnings projections because economy and companies are doing better than expected. This is once again a slightly technical chart, but some of you who are interested, this may just help you. So I will quickly touch upon. So Nifty comprises of some of these sectors, and there is a weight given next to it. So banking and financial is 38% of the weight of the Nifty free float market. When you construct portfolio, or your advisor constructs your portfolio, always the idea is to beat Nifty growth. We say growth vis-a-vis benchmark. And what's the benchmark typically? Nifty growth. So when you construct the portfolio or your investments, when you benchmark it to these weights, your chances of winning will be higher, or your chances of beating the index growth will be higher. So typically what we do is we find out the winners within sector, over allocate to those sectors. And within that, we find out the winner stocks to over-allocate in those stocks. So this is how that banking and finance is the highest weight, followed by technology.
And I'm so sorry to interrupt you. Can you kindly explain this about allocating the stocks along the sector?
How to use this? Correct. So I'm saying that when we construct, say, a portfolio of 1 crore of anybody's investments, our idea is, so markets cannot be looked at in short term. And for market, short term is 1 year, okay? And long term is 5 years and above. So in 1 year, what you want to see is that whether your investments are giving returns better than Nifty returns. Now, if you want to beat Nifty growth, say from 8,000 to 15,000, that is the percentage growth Nifty has given over some period of time. If you want to beat that, you have to see how the weightage of different sectors in Nifty is. Supposing I put my 50% of money in Maruti. Maruti will go up, for example, 30%, and banking and finance has weight of 38%, which goes 60%, my portfolio cannot outperform Nifty. So while constructing portfolio or investments, we give importance to this weightages of sectors, when I expand, I also have within this sector which stock has what weightage. Maybe that slide is not here. And so what we do, if you see here, like banking and finance, PAT growth is 16%, 27% and 20%. Now compared it to metal sector's growth of 18 and 2%. Compared that to say consumer sector growth. So when we inter-compare the sectors, we know which are the winning sector to which we allocate more money. When we open this and see the nifty stocks which are with weight, we know that which companies are giving more growth. And then you allocate and pick the winners based on this. But that detail analysis, how we really do that fundamental analysis and pick the winner, one of the sessions we have already kept. Here, one more important thing to look at is the, if you see EPS free float. So for FY20, 439 rupees EPS. 21, otherwise, due to COVID, we would have assumed it is a negative growth. But still, we are going to show 11% growth. But 22 will be a bumper year if you see 33% growth we are seeing. And on the top of the 33% growth, with whatever visibility right now we have, we are still seeing a 16% growth. And always every quarter with results, these earnings growth undergo changes based on the actual economy and the performance of the companies. So we also have our PL model portfolio. And that's how I said that nifty weightage of the sector where we are overweight. For example, in automobiles, we are very overweight. Banks also, we are overweight. Construction engineering, we are equal weight. Healthcare, we are slightly overweight. Plus some things with some non-nifty stocks also to get that additional growth. Metals, we are slightly underweight. NBFC,
one more close.
Sorry? Anything? Okay. So this also reflects the stocks and the sector allocation and the model portfolio performance also. So this is what broadly the broader way of looking at Indian market is. I would also like to take few more minutes to touch upon not markets, but the investments. So one is knowing the markets, knowing the stocks. Second is your investment discipline. So I always say what information you have doesn't make any difference what money you make. What your conviction on the information or understanding is, what your ability to hold your emotion is, and your ability to allocate capital to that particular understanding decides how much money you are finally making. So to seasoned, educated audience that I'm talking to, who's very capable of either continuing their journey if they are involved in the markets or starting in case they are not. Very important to always self-introspect and develop your emotional and mental abilities, because it is finally that which will decide how much money you can make in the markets. Markets will always give you that panic as well as euphoria. You have to be balanced during both those times, as well as you can trade, why not? But better be very sure that you are allocating say 30 to 40% of your capital for trading. Trading is only one rule globally. Trading has to have a stop loss. And what is the rule for investments? The rule for investment is review. What does that review mean? Review doesn't mean price upar gaya ki niche gaya. Review means what has happened to the business of the company where I am partner? Is it losing market share? Is there disruption, digital disruption? Is there any global competition? This is what we call review. So trading needs stop loss and investments needs review, and money is made based on your mental discipline. So this is my key advice to all of you who are into the journey or want to do the journey. I think, and I wish this was a useful session. Don't know how much time you all have, because you all wanted me to talk a bit about my journey too.
Yes.
But I would request to tell me what time we have at hand.
We are having, ma'am, time. This is a 1.5 hour session. So you could please share your journey. It is very inspiring. I mean, we very much learn from whatever you have shared. And we would surely want to hear you more, ma'am. And then we'll take the question answer session. Members are having questions. They can post in the meantime. You may please share your journey, ma'am.
Okay. Sure. So as what Hema, CA Hema said, that I started my journey as an analyst. And the first company that I was looking at being a young CA at 22 was Tata Motors. And I was fortunate that I got this opportunity to be systematic about investments at an early age. And, you know, because we all had learned about the marginal cost, fixed cost, variable cost. So I went into the whole schedules of their costs, and for each cost, I saw their 3 year trend and then kept projecting for next 2 years. And the numbers of automobile also I projected. When I did that for Tata Motors, which was in, economy was also down those years, 88, 89, and Tata Motors as a stock was not doing so great. But the numbers, the actual numbers were improving. And I then went to my boss and said, boss, I feel from a minus 6% EBITDA, this company will show within 2 quarters, 16% EBITDA. And of course, he laughed at me. I was just very young. But then I took him through my entire spreadsheet. And fortunately for me, being so methodical about my analysis helped. And Tata Motors from 60, 65 rupees, in one and a half year was 600 rupees. And till date, now I do many more things. I don't do only research, but if any analyst team comes to me, I always say, show me your operating model. What are your assumptions? And how is your operating metrics built? Now, non-professional investors may not do that, but at least they may not just do hearsay investments if they are like my fellow colleagues and chartered accountants. So I definitely would like this to be a base. Post this portfolio management and research game, and by the time I earned 1800 rupees a month, and despite being a girl, every evening I used to think, hey, what will I do with this 1800 rupees? And then within 2 years, BSE was giving professional category card. And one of the chartered accountants, one more other chartered accountant, got a professional category card. And he happens to know me. So he said, why don't you come and start my card? Because he had his own practice. And being the entrepreneur bug in my this one, I took an opportunity at around when I was, I think, 23 or 24. And that was the time when India was opening up, 91, 92, with that FIs were allowed and so on. So I set up their institutional business, and hardly any, I mean, 3 to 10 brokers would be, 10, 12 Indian brokers would be doing systematic research. And I had opportunity to do that research. So I started my institutional business with this broker. And of course, all the domestic mutual funds or banks started dealing with us. And when this opening up happened, you know, I started my career, to be very frank. I used to go to Hong Kong, Singapore with my colleagues and teams and my partner. we used to see below the building the big names of FIs, then go to our room, check out from the diary their names, then call them up, fix up our own appointment. But the best part was, while after meeting, throughout my journey, I have never asked any of my clients, business kab dega, business kab chalu karega. Fortunately, I have never to do that. We used to always go with our own homework on whatever stocks, economy, and what they should invest in and why. And one principle which we used to always keep while talking to clients, that whatever we want to say should sum up of a stock should be increment. If it goes to 10, the listener will lose the interest. And somehow that principle worked. When he is interested, we can go to any length. And then we started doing very good FIA business in those early days. At some point, then I moved to Prabhudas Leeladhar. That is not my first, this one. But at some point, then I moved to Prabhudas Leeladhar. And immediately after that, that Ketan Parekh crisis happened and the Badla stopped and so on and so forth. So Prabhudas Leeladhar was a very leading name that those days also doing FI business, but the entire business in Badla business was stuck. And they were also thinking that institutional business, which is with all these IIT, MBAs, costly affair, they should shut it down. But me being me, I thought this is a phenomenal long-term business. I had taken the mental to do their FI business. So I moved ahead and said that, okay, give me an opportunity to retain this team. I promise we will break even. I'll not make you lose in this business, whatever bad the market says. So our business had come down to 10% of the original business. I remember I took a 70% cut voluntarily and called entire of my team and said, whosoever, whatever cut you all can take, you decide. I am taking so much. And with that, we arrived at some monthly sum of the cost and which we all decided that we have to earn. So we started those days at something in 2002-03 at 90 lakh brokerage on a monthly run rate basis. Markets did very well after that, post that 2003 global crisis. So by 2007-08, we did business of about 110 crores. From 90 lakhs to 1 crore journey to 110 crores journey, touchwood, was very satisfying. And one of the key thing, I always single day would have been the one where I would not have spoken to one corporate and post markets would not have gone and meet one client. So all of you who are the budding entrepreneur business driven people, my key advice is, jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. Being in front of your client is very critical. And also, let me all tell you that I'm a Jain and I was very staunch Jain those days. And this industry is fully with, globally, with also largely all men. And they are spoiled to another level for entertaining by all the FI broking houses. And I have never ever entertained a single client either with a drink or a non-veg dinner. And fortunately, even when I used to travel to say Boston or California, my client would find a place where I can get a Jain food. Why I am saying this is the power of your homework. I have never gone to my client meetings without knowing his full portfolio, having my view on each of his stocks, why, and my way of adding some value as to what switch he should do in his portfolio. And touchwood, that has always helped me. Because as I always say as a woman, that is the only power that I have in my hand, which nobody can snatch, is my ability to do hard work. And I always want that should be our ability, that nobody can beat us in hard work. Number of hours, nobody can beat us, because that becomes then your biggest asset. I remember also that at times when I wanted to break, say, particular account in US, break in the sense I wanted to service that account also as an organization. So when they give meeting and they will say, KO, I want you 4 p.m. I'll pack the bag, I'll get the flight, same night I will travel. US used to take whatever 16, 18 hours and I'll be there for the meeting. I never say no for a meeting. And all the preparation happens on the way to the tour. Having said that, we also had, then we, with this money that we earned, whatever arrangement we had with the Prabhudas Lather, we thought, and they also thought, to offer partnership. So we now, instead of the share of profit directly being withdrawn, we took equity shares. At some point of time with the capital, we put this NBFC and investment banking. And by the way, all the investment banking deals also, which I used to do, is because we used to be with all the corporates traveling, doing roadshows, and that helped us understand what they really need, when do they need capital. And then we took this retail journey, which I never used to manage before retail. I was always a
corporate
client facing person. Retail is a team building business. And fortunately, I got the opportunity to even understand that. And when I had to start that journey into retail, the one thing which is imbibed as a principle is service. So I said earlier, I used to service my client. Now is the time to service my team. So client faces or my team faces, it's my responsibility to remove that. And that approach helped me expand my team, retain my team. Of course, we are not the best. Much more needs to be done, but this is how I have been looking at business. I have been looking at work. And, you know, being Jains, there are many, many things you need to do for your spiritual upliftment. And I always in my career used to think that if anything which I do, if I do it sincerely, that itself is my spiritual upliftment. When I become insincere and put my focus somewhere else and show that I'm doing this, that is my spiritual downward journey. So being focused, being sincere is one of the other things which I have been always keeping in mind. And my dreams are always ahead of wherever I am, and that continues to be even now. So this is what broadly my story has been. Yes, somewhere when client recognition used to come as best salesperson from Asia Money and all that, because it comes by voting by clients. I don't think any of these awards or being a school first or college first was ever celebrated at any of my house. We never been doing any parties. And up till now, the fact always was that time is so precious. Why not to invest in reading something or knowing something more? But yes, when I look back, some of this recognition gives me a lot of satisfaction. And I also take this opportunity to definitely tell all the women over here on this group that there will be a period when you will have to juggle between your responsibilities in your career and your personal life, right through that, but don't give up. Because ultimately, giving justice to your own potential is also equally important. And of course, the best thing which all others who are men here, they can do is to take equal responsibility with their partners so that both of you can have full fulfillment about your careers and your life. With this, I stop and request if anybody of you have questions, then I'll be willing to take it. I hope you found this session useful. Thank you so much.
Very much, ma'am. It has been very, very useful and inspiring. In fact, there are comments for, you know, appreciating your session. There are a few questions, ma'am. One, Kaushal Shah, he is requesting give an idea on RSI and how it is used in trading.
So what I request is we are going to have a detailed session on technical analysis, no?
Right.
So why not we take up then this particular question?
Right. So even the next one, I think, would get fall into the same category, but just I'll put it across to you and you may take a call. Should we as investors also diversify in US stock market, or should it be primarily focused on Indian market considering the projections for growth? Ma'am, do you recommend any books?
So definitely, I think investments in US markets should be done. US market, you know, there is a debate going on that US market capitalization, US GDP is say 32% of global economy, market cap is 60% of global economy, dominated by the top 8-10 stocks, and so it is hugely out of sync with their GDP. But the other argument which I always put is that the top 8 to 10 stocks are not restricted to providing services or goods to US economy. They are global companies. For example, Apple or Netflix, we all are using and consuming it. And why then their comparison should be to US economy and US GDP? To extrapolate this argument, I would say that US will continue to be the hub of innovation and will keep taking market share globally. So investments in US based on those limits, I would very strongly recommend.
Ma'am, do you recommend any books that one could read for upgrading their analytics on the financials?
So I would say that, you know, book reading is going to be very important. For example, after my son finished his studies, the first year I asked him is that you have to focus on only two things. You read and understand about all the leading investors globally. We all know it's only Warren Buffett or few others like Philip Fisher or many, many others which are current. Once you read about them, one thing which you will realize is that for investments, a framework is important. And when you study a little more in next few sessions, you will understand that what does framework mean? For example, my framework of identifying good stock was, is their next 3 years growth better than last 3 years growth? Is their next 3 years cash flow better than last 3 years cash flow? And is their next 3 years ROE in rising trend and better than last 3 years? Then this can be a winning stock. Apart from corporate governance, these, that, some of the other things. So all the different investors have their frameworks. And to arrive at for your own investments framework, there are two ways. You can go through the books or invest of these leading investors. But the better thing I would recommend is to go through YouTube videos. That gives you very easy understanding. So now I recommend most of the people going through the videos first. The list of book is very large and that can be provided separately also, depending on his exact interest. If you can organize to, touch base on email, I will definitely give very specific books also.
Thank you. Another member, Devan Shah, is mentioning whether we should compare GDP growth with index growth.
So, you know, markets always go ahead of the fundamentals. When down cycle also, up cycle also. So a linear comparison is not possible. Broader comparison is possible, but not in terms of time and linear. Right now we say we are in super cycle. So, you know, markets may have correction because of either border issues or the bond yields going up above a particular range globally or in India or some unseen factor that we don't know. But we still say that markets will be broadly in a very good territory over the next 3 to 5 years because we think that the economy will do very well. But you can't have a one-to-one linkage.
Another member is mentioning Bhaskar Gandhi about which currencies are affecting our capital market.
Largely dollar. So because of the so much of printing of dollar globally, and that the view broadly is that dollar will lose a bit of its charm, so much money is coming into emerging markets. That's one of the key reasons for the emerging markets performance, including India. So dollar continues to be the dominant currency.
Mr. Pawan Chaudhary, he wants to know idea about India VIX.
So India VIX continues to be a little high than average. It continues to be at 20-23. On a complete risk off mode or a stable market, it goes down to 11-11.5 also. So markets does reflect high degree of risk even now.
Is it likely that bond yield will go up globally in the near term?
Bond yields are strengthening globally. I think that the effort of the Fed will continue to keep it doused. And the second package in US is also likely to come, which will again flush, but the economy with liquidity and so on. But over the next 12 months, I think the trajectory will continue to be when bond yields will go up, and that will have a key risk for the markets. And domestically also, I feel that the bond yields over a period will continue to firm up.
Ravi Parikh wants to know, can Bitcoin affect the share market?
I would rather say that, you know, in India, for whatever reasons, we are not currently in a position within India to have that investments opportunity. We can, of course, invest outside within our limits, but I think that that will continue to be a very good class of assets or investments, and it will give very good appreciation, because when the largest economy is debasing its currency completely and printing, either it is gold, but beyond gold, it's Bitcoin, which I think will do very well.
Mr. Satish wants to know, what was the projections in May, June 2020?
For the markets or the economy? I think the economy, if the economy, then the worst case was -12, -13% GDP, which now we say is -7 or 7.5. And the projections for earnings growth, I think nobody, including corporates or analysts, had a project visibility, because nobody knew when the unlocking will happen and so on. So the debate used to be whether it will be K-shaped, C-shaped, L-shaped or V-shaped recovery. So I think predictions over a period of time has totally changed based on both the amount of money supply which kept on happening globally, but beyond that, the control a large economy like India could bring over COVID.
Parthiv Chauhan wants to know the top 3 points which you should keep in mind when analyzing balance sheet for investing long term.
Free cash flow. Free cash flow generation. Free cash flow means cash flow after investments in working capital, increasing working capital, and investments in CapEx. The free cash flow generation is one of the key factors which decides the strength of the business model where you want to become a partner. The other factor in balance sheet, and that actually to other thing, but if you still want to see from trend perspective, the increase in data days is the other critical factor that we look at. And we frown upon if the number of data days or number of stock days, inventory days are going up, which means somewhere the competitive strength either is lost or there could be some fudging. I think now fudging is less, reasonably less, but that indicates some issue. So that is second point. And third point we always see is what is the operating leverage the business enjoys, which means the proportion of fixed and variable cost. And with rising turnover, does operating leverage kick in, or you have to just keep on passing on to customers? So these are the three things for strength of a business model that we typically look at.
And what are the three points which a trader must look at?
So a trader definitely needs to look at so buy on rumor, sell in news is one key principle. Second, for a more thorough work, now the two, three other things that they can look at is built up in futures and options side, which reflects how much has things already been in, increase in volume, because these two things reflect the interest. And the third thing I would say that a trader can keep in mind is the liquidity in the counter. So you should always trade in very liquid counters. That goes without saying. So you can't say that I want to trade, but that too in a B group illiquid share. That is not possible. Trader should be able to reverse the trade at a zippy.
I think if we have crossed our time, ma'am. There are two more questions. If you could please just answer that before we wind it up quickly. There is one question, how to hedge your positions in futures and options?
So I would suggest that this is a very important question, because your portfolio not only can be hedged, but by doing some simple strategies, you can earn based on your portfolio while it is appreciating. But my team will definitely take it up in the next sessions. So either Sandeep in the next session can take it up, or when we do the derivative and technical session, you will come to know about it.
Right. So I think the questions which are left, they'll be taken up in the further sessions which are going to be held. On behalf of Ahmedabad branch of WIRC of ICA, ma'am, I propose a hearty vote of thanks. I thank you so much for sharing your entire journey, which has been inspiring, and your knowledge, which has, you know, been very useful for each one of us, both the, you know, regulars and the people who want to start this journey. So with this, I thank you, and we take forward with us your qualities of hard work, sincerity, dedication, focus, and the most important thing which you said, you know, to balance your emotional and mental ability to stay put in the market because of the ups and downs that it goes through. So thank you so much, ma'am. We look forward to have you in many more of our future sessions as well.
Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to be with my fraternity, all the CAs. And I'll be very happy that if it makes a little difference also in that journey, then my time invested will be really worth it. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Anjali, Hema, and Brijesh Bhai.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
We will be carrying forward with our next session, friends. Please be online. Very soon, we will be starting that.
Good evening, everyone. I, CA Silva Shah, take this opportunity to proceed for the next session for the day. The faculty for the next session of the day will be Mr. Sandeep Raichura, an alumnus of Sri Ram College of Commerce, Delhi. Sandeep Raichura is a postgraduate from the Delhi School of Economics. He is also an EEP from IIM Bangalore. He heads one of the leading stockbroking firms in India, which offers services like derivative broking, investment banking, corporate advisory, share trading, and many more. Prabhu Das Leela does non-institutional business as a CEO. He also supervises the operations of the retail business across the country. Without taking I would request our next faculty to take over. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Silva. Thank you to the Institute for having us over. It's our absolute pride and privilege to be associated with you for this virtual series. It's an indeed opportune moment because you've just won, the Ahmedabad Charter just won one of the most prestigious awards. So I congratulate every single member of the community of the Institute for having achieved this milestone. And thank you, especially for having us over at this time when you are celebrating this. The trouble of coming to speak after Amisha has spoken, it's like a cricket analogy, where a film star comes and dazzles everybody with their brilliance, and then suddenly you have to watch a match between, Kenya and Zimbabwe. So this is the Kenya-Zimbabwe match. I hope that I can do justice to your expectations. I've kept the presentation small. In fact, it's the number of slides in my presentation are smaller than the awards that Amisha keeps winning for her expertise in this area. I promise to keep it short. I also wanted to say something that Amisha briefly touched upon. One more reason why this entire session is probably coming at the right time is that the next 6 or 7 years, I think Amisha referred to it as the golden period for investments, are going to be extra critical because it's possibly going to be a repeat of what we saw in terms of buoyancy across asset classes between 2003 and 2008. A similar kind of global rally might emerge over the next 7 or 8 years, seems to be the consensus. And luckily for us, we belong to a country where, and possibly more than most Asian economies, and definitely very close to what the Western world is developed to. As an investor or as a participant, as an intermediary in this market, it's a, by the way, a $300 trillion market. So it's a huge gamut of instruments available internationally. It's going to be an exciting time over the next 6 or 7 years. And luckily for us, the Indian regulators have possibly given Indians as many options to invest as are possibly available to investors in Western markets, across asset classes. However, the agenda over the next couple of days is to essentially talk about basics of investing, followed by the next 2 days of sessions on fundamentals, technicals, and derivatives. I'm hoping that you find all of these very exciting. Like I said, my session is more like the Zimbabwe-Kenya match. So investing, one thing that I need to definitely say is not one-day cricket or not a T20, it's a test match, right? And I wanted to start off my session with this request that we approach the world of investing, our own finances, in a very disciplined, test match-oriented fashion and possibly stick to certain basic principles. So every time you look at an opportunity available to you, whether it's a fixed deposit or a mutual fund, or your friend tells you about stocks, etc., there are some 6 or 7 basic principles that you have to stick to. And my presentation broadly talks about those principles of investing, which hopefully would make you a slightly better investor if you already did not know. If you find the presentation extremely basic, my apologies. But then I've learned over the last 22, 23 odd years that, certain principles in investing are evergreen. And you may at times forget these. And this session at least gives you the opportunity to visit these principles again. So without wasting any more time, let me go over to my presentation. Silva, I hope this is visible. Can somebody confirm if this is visible?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. So like I said, I'll start off with the presentation is split across four key areas, investing basics, what we mean by risk return and asset allocation, certain pitfalls that in the journey of investing one needs to avoid, and certain resources that anybody and everybody can use to make their investing journey more peaceful and more profitable. Now, before we get to investing, we have to remember that there are two steps prior to investing, and those are very, very essential. First, difficult job is to make money itself, right? That's what life is about. Now, once you've made money, you end up typically putting it in a bank. Now, that's not called investing. That's called saving. Investing is a much more conscious decision, which essentially says that, you know, the difference between saving and investing is that investing means you take a conscious decision of what you're going to do with your money. It's not lazy money that's lying around in a bank account. And also at the same time, you should know what other people who are managing your money are doing with your money, right? And that's the core difference between investing and saving. Putting it in a, you know, under the pillow or in the mattress or giving it to a bank is not investing, that's saving. There are certain terms that the investing world uses very often. So let me clarify, although this looks simplistic, but the fact is that when we meet investors, a lot of them say that I invest in fixed deposits. And therefore we have to keep reiterating that investments is not just about where you put the money, meaning commitment of funds to a particular asset class, but it's also about knowing the risk that you're willing to take on that particular investment. So it's a conscious decision. You have to evaluate your options, which I'll visit soon. Of course, as an investor, you have two options. You can choose to invest your money passively. Passively means, you know, you could broadly, you know, follow a particular asset class and say that, you know, it's like, for example, gold. You know, you buy gold and, you know, gold decides how much your money grows. That's essentially passive investing. And an active investment strategy, which involves you to take a decision on who can manage your money, how much money are you willing to give to that person, and if that person is not performing, what do you intend to do with that money, and if you switch out, where will you, you know, give that money. So essentially, it brings us to two kinds of investing options available to all of us. Something called direct investing, where you need to know the universe of investable options, and then decide how you're going to invest, by directly reading or, you know, researching yourself. That's called direct investing. The other option is that instead of taking the pains yourself, you give your money over to people who are willing to manage your money for a fee. So for example, via mutual funds, via ETFs, and so on and so forth.
One thing, sir.
I'm sorry. Okay. So investing is not just about deciding whether you're going to be a direct investor or an indirect investor. It's also not about just deciding whether you want to be active or passive. It should also be linked to specific objectives in life. So broadly speaking, if you are planning for something 6 months down the line, you cannot be investing in something that has a lock-in or that is a closed-ended thing for 5 years. You know, so specific objectives have to be evaluated before you take investing decisions. As an investor in India, you've got hundreds of options to invest from. We've got more than 2,600 or 700 odd stocks listed on exchanges, which are fairly well traded. On the NSE, for example, you've got hundreds of mutual fund schemes. During Amisha's session, somebody also referred to, you know, whether international stocks can be bought into. The international stock investing universe has expanded or exploded in the last couple of years. Indians are pouring a lot of money abroad using these routes. Of course, we have the conventional sources. I have not mentioned insurance because we really don't consider insurance as an investing class. But, you know, typically investing via PFs, via government bonds, corporate bonds, deposits, etc. You've got a new instrument in the markets over the last 4 or 5 years, which are market-linked debentures. That comes on the fixed income side. We obviously have things like liquid funds, current accounts, money market funds. And now, after the latest policy of the RBI, retail investors can also invest into government T-bills. You know, so we've got a lot of investing options even in that kind of space where returns are broadly fixed. And of course, there are newer emerging asset classes like real estate, gold, private equity, alternative investment funds. So broadly, there are a wide variety of very, very exciting options available to an average investor. However, just availability, and Prabhudas Leeladhar, for example, we were counting, we have about 17 asset classes available with us. But does that mean that you need to invest in every single thing that we present to you? No, of course not. Why do you invest? So investing is a personal decision which is primarily based on what you're investing for. So is it for your retirement? Is it for a particular goal about, you know, n number of months or years down the line? For example, you know, a very large expense on a house that you've always dreamed about. Is it for school education, or further, you know, further down the line, maybe about 5 years or 10 years when your, you know, kids are still young and probably in school or just born? Or any large investment like a vacation abroad that you're actually planning to spend on. Now, all of these are very serious decisions in your life. Investing, therefore, is also very serious business. You cannot be investing in a way which is not commensurate with your future goals. And one last thing, investing is definitely not speculating. So, you know, taking tips from your neighbor and from the panwala and from television is not called investing. We would classify it in something called play money or speculating. Now, one thing that we all need to know, you know, when we are investing into any asset class, and I'm not talking equities, although people think about equities immediately. Investing is about, you know, taking a conscious risk on your money, and then managing that risk in a wide variety of ways that I'll mention some slides later. Invest any opportunity to make money apart from probably government guaranteed deposits is not going to come without risk. Every asset class has a potential risk, and every asset class by default, therefore, carries a potential return. People who invest in high yielding FDs have burned their hands. People who invested in penny stocks with their life savings and pensions burned their hands. So it essentially boils down to knowing two or three things that I'll mention in the next few slides. Risk is not just about underperformance of where you've invested. It also relates to what if you suddenly wanted to withdraw the money in a particular investment and realize that it is at the bottom of what you could have imagined was the worst case. It can apply to any asset. I mean, while we think of, you know, stock markets, it could actually apply to if you have a floating rate deposit, floating rate funds, it could apply to that. If you have a liability, which in a time of decreasing rates of interest still holds you at 9%, you know, home loan rates, for example, right? It could be any asset class. And therefore, you need to know the asset class. You need to know the potential worst case and then figure out what is the ideal combination so that you can reach your objectives. This entire spectrum of decision-making is a very conscious process. It has to be a very responsible and well thought through process. It is your life's savings after all. Like I said, no return comes without risk. Even banks, I mean, a lot of us are chartered accountants and we take decisions on a daily basis, I'm sure. Even banks, when they give out personal loans, I mean, to somebody they might charge, let's say, a 9%, and to somebody they might charge a 14%, and microfinance may charge maybe 24%. Essentially, the higher the return, the higher the risk. And that's the formula across, you know, asset classes that we deal with, whether as investor or as career professionals or even as chartered accountants. This principle essentially also underlies the investable universe. Conventionally, the asset classes are mapped out like this, where we say that low return and low risk instruments are typically mutual funds and cash equivalents like current accounts, etc. And on the other extreme, you know, you might invest into things like penny stocks, and somebody mentioned bitcoins, etc. Of course, high risk and high investing, right? Now, the challenge is in deciding not which of these you want to select, but how much of these you want to select. And that will bring us to the question of asset allocation, which I'll cover briefly at a later stage. A lot of people have burned their hands in equities. And I took this chart. This is a two-year-old chart deliberately because in March 2018, the markets had corrected very, 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 very badly. after January 2018's crash. We were at possibly the bottom or the worst scenario in terms of a stock market collapse, where mid-caps had stocks had collapsed almost 50-60%. 80% of the markets were down over a five-year period. Even at that point in time, if you had invested over a 10-year period, you would have still made a 7.5% tax-free return. Now, that's the nature of equity market. Now, if you have a longer horizon, I can present many charts. I could have presented a chart which relates to returns now when we are at all-time highs, but then that may not have given you the picture of what I'm trying to say. And what I'm saying is that as the economy progresses, as the nation liberalizes, as the post-COVID era returns, as global economies, especially in, you know, Eastern Europe and the pigs economies, as we call them, stumble back into growth over the next 7 or 8 years, you can just imagine what would happen to equity returns, which even in the worst year had still given you a 7.5% tax-free return. So we have to remember that equities generate returns, but then they generate returns over a long period of time. The other risk in investing, it has nothing to do with what you decided, etc. It's a silent, you know, risk, which we all know about, but maybe we don't consciously evaluate. I meet lots of people who invested their entire lifetime savings into deposits and still talk about bonds and, you know, safety of returns, etc. And what
Hello.
Hello.
Ah, Samik. अरे नीले बात तो बका अबे मैं फोन इतने कर रहा हूँ कि पहलू कितने कॉपी मोकले से तू ना एक मारे ऑफिस में भी डाक भी पसंद प्राण कर देना
सिल्वर कैन आई कंटिन्यू
ना हाँ ना बका ओरे
यस सर यू कैन
ये वाला मारा सिक्का रहा था बेंडी ने मी साइन को लाइन मारा ऑफिस कॉपी
रखा नीला शाह तो प्लीज म्यूट योरसेल्फ
रिपोर्ट रखो पड़े ना
Nilesha, kindly mute yourself.
Oh, itla mathe. Barabar ne pachi evo to pachi password the apne kare. Are tu ha mo itle chodi ek copy the extra.
I think Nilesha is already taking investing decisions.
So
I'll try and continue.
Aste me ek copy mokli the copy.
Please do let me know if I'm not audible. So inflation even at 6% per annum typically over a 30-year period
routine that you know about
I'm sorry Silva I think I might not be audible because of
the yeah yeah just a moment sir just a moment I'm trying to mute
no alle pachi are em nahi to pachi bija pehla bada jate jate karai le se to pachi itne kam sun to chalo vaando
I would request Nilesha
અચ્છા એવું છે વાર્ષિક જ તો બધાને ક્વાર્ટરલી જ કરાવી દે ને ભાઈ આપણે અને બેનને ક્યારે મેળ પડે આ બેન જોડે ક્યારે આ ઠીક છે છોડો વાંધો જા રહે થઈ હા બેન જોડે ક્યારે મળવાનું કારણ કે આમાં યાર ટાઈમ તો ખાસો જાય છે એટલે આ તો એમનું સારું હતું એટલે કામ
કરી આઈ એમ નોટ એબલ ટુ મ્યુટ હિમ
આઈ
I think yes, you can
continue. Sure. Okay. So you know, essentially, inflation is a silent killer. Without realizing, if you've invested your money,
Nilesha, can you please mute yourself? Yes, sir. Please continue. I'm extremely sorry for the.
No problem. I can answer. So anyway, so what I was saying was that apart from the risk of volatility, which we all know, you know, rates keep going up and down, stock markets keep going up and down, etc. Regulations can change, you know, throwing new risks at investors in things like real estate, etc. The other side of the extreme, where we are meeting customers and you know they put 80-90% of their money into fixed deposits and insurance plans, which give 5% you know bonus additions, etc. One thing that you know people don't take into account is the fact that you know over for a typical 30-year-old who's going to be putting money for let's say the next 30 years till he retires does not realize that the value of his money will erode by almost 90% because inflation will eat into whatever returns he's getting from these so-called safe investments. So these are not safe investments. This is the other extreme. So as an investor, we need to be conscious. High risk does not only mean volatility. High risk also means whether the investing opportunities that you have allocated to are at least beating inflation. This needs to be kept in mind. The reason it has to be kept in mind, like I said, is that, you know, you don't only have retirement, you also need to take a lot of decisions along the way between the time that you start working to the time that you retire, where things like, you know, building a house, children's college, school, marriage, you know, any bulk expenses, et cetera, have to be taken into account post adjusting for inflation and taxes. So it's a very serious exercise that one needs to do. Asset allocation, typically what we tell people is the best way to beat risk and to have, you know, peaceful sleep. Now, thumb of rule typically says that if you're investing into, you know, things like equities or equity funds or, you know, things like mid-cap stocks, etc., you need to have at least a 5-year horizon, right? So when you think of a stock, the first thing that should come to mind is not what it's going to, you know, make tomorrow morning from an investing point of view, but what it is likely to be 5 years from now. And in one of the sessions that we're going to do over the next couple of days, you'll be taken through what is called valuation and therefore valuation gap and how you can identify growth stocks and value stocks that can give good returns over a long period of time. If you're at the other extreme and you're talking about capital preservation, so for example, you've got expenses at home or there's uncertainty, you want to keep some cash at home, you know, if you've got especially, you know, senior citizens at home, that money cannot be in stock markets. That money needs to be in, you know, shorter term deposits or, you know, T-bills or money market mutual funds and the like. These are all very serious decisions. So not only should you know how much risk you're willing to take, not only should you know what time and what goals you're planning for, not only should you know your instruments that you're familiar with and your you know, broker or intermediary is advising you, but most importantly, the time frame involved in each goal, which will ultimately decide what we call asset allocation. Asset allocation is very simple. It basically says that once you know the time frame involved, you know, you should ideally diversify your investments across a lot of asset classes and within each asset class, a lot of instruments. It's not a science. I mean, obviously you'll find on Google, and I'm sure that the Chartered Accountant Institute would know about things like portfolio optimization, etc. But the fact of the matter is that every asset class does not behave similarly, right? Currencies are up, equities are down, dollar is up, markets are down, fixed income, I mean, the longer term interest rates are up, equities are up. So, you know, things move differently from each other. And the challenge is to find an asset allocation which actually gives you not only the opportunity to earn the returns that you have planned for, but also earn them at the risk that you are willing to take in the time frame that you are willing to invest for, and therefore have a peaceful investing life. That essentially is what asset allocation means. In simple language, you know, there's the rule of 100 minus 8. So for example, if you are a, you know, 30-year-old, the typical rule is, and you could follow very different rules, the difference is not very high, but if you're just sort of starting out your career, you should have 100 minus 30, for example, 70% in equities, you know, or if one is in the 40s and one is planning for retirement, one could do what is called balanced investing, which means, you know, roughly 50% in high risk, high return things like stocks and about, you know, 40 to 50% in things which give predictable returns or things which give security like insurance and real estate, etc. By insurance, I mean protection to your life and your assets, not as an investing class. But one thing that I believe in is that you should always, irrespective of how much money you've made, if you are not exactly sure, especially if you're a businessman or your income stream is uneven, always ensure that you have 10% always available in your portfolio in terms of cash, which can be withdrawn overnight. What diversification does, or what asset allocation essentially does, is to ensure that you're not subjected to individual asset class volatilities, but you earn what is commensurate with your risk return profile. So it sort of averages out the returns across asset classes, but while doing that, it also averages out the risk to a level which you can, you know, sort of absorb. However, one thing important, because we also meet investors who say, I'm very well diversified, you know, holding 20, you know, for example, cement stocks in a portfolio is not called diversification. diversification requires you to sit with your portfolio, and I don't mean the stock portfolio, I mean your entire investment basket, including deposits and real estate and jewelry and so on and so forth, and consciously thinking about whether your portfolio is really diversified. I mean, 20 stocks of, you know, the same behavior is not diversification. It's just that you're spending too much money trying to invest wildly or without reason or rationale. What is diversification? Diversification is essentially, you know, blending your portfolio in a way where some of your portfolio is behaving cyclically, which means it's going along with, you know, where the economy is headed or where liquidity is headed. And some bit of it will gain when the economy reverses. It also means you should have companies or asset classes where, you know, if interest rates go up, you know, there are earners of interest rate in your portfolio, like, for example, banks, and there are interest spenders, like, for example, infra companies which spend. So is there a blend between the two? Is there a blend between, you know, international diversified, you know, companies who also have a large international, you know, revenue in dollars versus people who earn revenue from the domestic economy only? So a lot of these considerations should go into what you should consider a diversified portfolio. Amisha mentioned this, so I'll not talk about it. But for example, we give out a diversified model portfolio for equity markets each month on our website. Now, asset allocation also is very important from the simple reason that if you don't believe in asset allocation, if you're not consciously doing this every quarter, you might also get into the typical greed and fear cycle. A lot of people, you know, 3 or 4 months ago, roughly from October onwards, would not have believed that the markets could indeed rally from 9,500 levels to about 15,000 levels in the next 4 months. I mean, nothing changed, right, on the ground. We still have COVID patients. In fact, there are, you know, in Maharashtra, for example, we are still at almost all-time highs. You know, globally, markets have been shut down. I'm told that, you know, Dubai, Singapore kind of places are not even open for tourists. In that kind of a scenario, you know, how is it that the market could rise from 9,500 to 15,000? But that's exactly what happens every decade, and this cycle will keep repeating. So if you are a person who believes that, you know, you will call the shots and invest in markets when they're at bottoms and you'll sell when they're at tops, I mean, you might be extremely well endowed, but there's a very high probability you will actually not make the amount of money that you could have made if you had followed simple principles of investing, which basically say that once you've decided to be in equities, as per your asset allocation, stay invested. Because if you miss even 3 or 4 months, you would have missed about 60% of the market return. You know, I made this slide earlier, but now we have the best example right in front of us. You know, if you had missed the last 4 months, your portfolio is still sitting in deep losses, right? Because we could not simply believe, and we waited and we waited and we waited, saying that the market someday will come down, right? A similar thing would have happened in mutual funds last year. You know, when we thought, you know, interest rates would go up, interest rates actually came down, and, you know, people in income funds made upwards of 14-15% in less than 6 months. So that it's not about timing markets. It's about deciding what you're going to invest in and for how long you're going to stay invested, and then believing in that principle and continuing to invest. So what is asset allocation? Like I said, it's about being clear about your goals, time horizon, how much risk you're willing to take. Understand from, and you could do it yourself or talk to, you know, professionals, intermediaries, find out what portfolio investing opportunities are available, which offer you that kind of a return with clearly defined risk. And then once you've bought into this portfolio across all your deposits, bonds, stocks, et cetera, you know, revisiting once in a quarter, not revisiting it every single day. Now, I just wanted to make this clear differentiation because some of you might be very, very actively invested in equities and you might say, you know, this guy is giving gyan about 70-30 and all that. When an investor sets out on a 15-20-30-year journey, whatever I just said is of immense value, and studies globally have proven that no mutual fund manager, no expert, nobody ultimately will be able to beat markets, and therefore asset allocation is 85 to 90% responsible for what you make over the longer term and not what stocks you bought into. However, at the same time, let's say Prabhudas Singhada comes out with a view that the markets are going to do extremely well and you are invested in a 70-30 asset allocation, which we refer to as a strategic asset allocation. It does not mean that you could not take a view and move from, let's say, 70% exposure to equities to 80%. That's called a tactical asset exposure. But what would be suicidal is moving to a 100% asset allocation or moving to a 20% asset allocation, because either of these two would increase your risk substantially. I mean, when you're at 20%, it's a risk of underperformance and not meeting your goals. And if it's 100%, it exposes your entire portfolio to a fall in markets. So something called tactical asset allocation is something you could revisit every quarter or every 6 months by taking a short-term view on all the asset classes. I'll quickly visit a couple of pitfalls in investing. I mean, asset allocation, deciding goals, etc., theoretically is very, very easy. But we make it very complicated because we listen to a lot of people. We look at our neighbors and wonder how, their money trebled and so on and so forth. One simple principle, if you cannot afford, let's say, a 20% loss in the stock market, once you've invested 100 rupees, you should not be in stocks, or you should be invested a little in stocks. You've got to take a conscious decision, and you cannot be saying, either of the two extremes. Because remember, whether or not you panic, whether or not you do this, the fact is that 20 years down the line, you're going to need some of this contribution from the stock markets. And like I showed, only, for example, stock markets are capable of giving you such returns. So you will have to get involved in consciously taking risk. You cannot run away from risk. In fact, somebody famous once said, the biggest risk of investing is not to be investing. People also see risk in very, very short time frame. So we get scared with red headlines on pink newspapers, which show us the graph on the left, which is typically, for example, a stock which may have fallen from X to Y. But if you expand your time frame and pick out any good quality stock, you will see that the same stock over longer time frames actually did pretty well. So why, when you're planning your horizon over a 20-year period for a particular goal, why do you have to look at 3-month and 1-day charts? Be conscious about why you're investing into what you're investing. This brings me to a very key point that, once you've invested, and unless you're in the stock markets yourself, do not look at what's happening to stock markets on a daily basis. This is unnecessary and actually ends up destroying wealth, because you end up either being too fearful or being too greedy and taking irrational decisions, which you would not have taken if you had kept a very, very long-term dispassionate point of view. So in fact, my one request to every investor is, please engage with us, but engage with us in a completely detached fashion, which sounds ironic, but it's very, very important if you have to make wealth. Also, one more thing that, a lot of people put very serious money into what I call play money. Just because everybody is doing it and everybody is buying a stock, we need to also be getting into it. You could possibly be doing a little bit of, play money kind of thing. But remember, when something is popular, you will hear about it in the media every single day. But when it falls off the cliff, nobody's going to mention it for the next 10 years, right? So if you're using a little bit of play money in your free time and you're very conscious that this is play money and this is not high value investing linked to specific goals, please do so. But like Amisha mentioned in her presentation, when you use play money, be disciplined. Keep things like stop losses. Do not take unnecessary risk. Now I'll come to the final thing that actually all of us have, and we are not doing it. Unfortunately, even though this is being done by more and more and more people, we are all scrambling for money, but we realize that even a little bit of money can actually help a lot if we value this particular resource. Amisha mentioned it in her own way, where time essentially adds to knowledge and wisdom and has built, what Amisha is today. Similarly, you can build your portfolios by using this very, very essential asset called time. Time is on everybody's side. There are tools available, even if you have little money, whether you have large money. The fact of the matter is you can start tomorrow morning, because once tomorrow is gone, that time is not coming back. We all know that. However, it's also a very, very important asset that can multiply your investments manifold. Investing, remember, is not for the super rich. In fact, they can invest their money in fixed deposits and live happily ever after. It is for the average investor to know asset allocation, to know investing, and also to know that there is something called systematic investing. This is a very, very important tool available to everybody. And as chartered accountants, I'm sure you know a lot more about things like present value and future discounted value. Just to give you an example, if you are somebody who can put 4 lakhs every year, and you earn just about 25% per annum. After about 25 years, this 4 lakhs each year would have become a sum of 32 crores. Now ask yourself, you know, many of you might actually be willing to easily invest this into an asset class which can generate a reasonable return and then forget about it. You don't have to watch television. You don't have to worry about where stock markets are headed. And this is just an annual investment. If you are short of money, you don't have the 4 lakhs to invest every month, every year, and you can't be investing at 25%, then what do you do? Very simple. You make it a regular investing of 15,000 or 10,000, let's say. I'll take the 15,000 example because the mathematics is very simple. If you don't have 4 lakhs, what you do is make it smaller investments, but then invest every month. Invest it at a lower return of 15%. And for 15 years, this itself multiplies your money to about 1 crore. You don't have, let's say, even 15,000 bucks when you're meeting a youngster. Doesn't matter. Invest just 5,000 rupees per month. Just in increase it by 5% every year whenever. Increase the investment value by just 5% every year. And when that person retires, he would have forgotten that he was investing, you know, just 5,000 rupees into something called a systematic investment plan into an asset class. He could have made as much as 27 crores. This is the power of time. When you don't have money available, the power of time is an asset class that comes to your help. So in summary, I would basically say that you have to be actively involved in the decisions to invest. You've got to make very conscious policies with your advisors or by yourself when you're discussing your investment plans. You've got to regularly monitor your investment performance and stay focused. Do not get waylaid by what's happening in markets and currencies and the dollar and the rupee and the blaring headlines on television, etc. And if you think you need advice, then come seeking professional advice from intermediaries like us. Before I end, just if in case it helps some of the younger audiences, I'm sorry if it's too basic for the senior professionals, but I thought these might be important. So if you want to read about things like fundamentals of a company and earnings estimates, etc., and get it also free, Google Finance is a very good resource. You want to play around with identifying stocks once you've learned much more over the next couple of days when we do our sessions on fundamentals and technicals, I would suggest that you go to a website called screener.in, which I think is a very, very nice free tool to use. You might learn about things like charting, charts and technicals and so on. I use a lot of chartinc.com. If you want to learn about things like model portfolios and what we like at Prabhudas Leela there, you should definitely visit our research section on our portal, plindia.com. Somebody asked about international investing and VIX and things like that, basic principles of investing. Please do visit our blog. Amisha mentioned YouTube videos on the internet. We have placed a lot of very, very exciting, very brief videos on our YouTube channel, which I'm sure would appeal to a lot of the audience which possibly wants to learn basics. If you wish to, we also at Prabhudas Leela come out with a lot of guided investing portfolios. I would welcome you to, even if you're not investing, just have a look at what the world of technology and the world of investing has come to, where you could start with as little an amount as 10,000 and you get, advisors advising you on a portfolio from day one and for the rest of your life. I would welcome you to see this. Somebody asked about international investing. It's become extremely easy. There are millions of dollars being invested every single month by Indians abroad. We've also created tools like that, which allow you to invest in international markets or ETFs. Things have become extremely easy. There are too many options. However, the challenge is understanding the asset classes, understanding your objectives, talking to professionals or analyzing markets yourselves or instruments yourselves, and then actually doing what is right for you and for you alone. That is the magic of investing. That is the basics of investing 101. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. I would request participants to come up with the questions if they have any. Participants can pose their questions for the subject.
So there is a question coming up from Nirali Trivedi.
Yes.
Yes, the PPT shall be shared. The PPT shall be shared soon. So the question is, how to hedge your position in a future and options segment?
Okay. I think the derivative session being done by our champion, Shilpa Rawat, and Shilpa Rawat, by the way, is extremely popular with traders and investors, would be the ideal forum because it's a slightly detailed topic. You need to understand some basic basics of options and derivatives instruments. I would request and suggest, because she's covered this topic also in her presentation that I'm aware of, if this question could be addressed to her on that day.
Thank you, sir. Another question is coming from Mr. Satish. The question is, how can we invest in China or emerging markets?
Right. So it's fairly easy, Satish ji, now. So there are broadly two easy ways to do this. One is there are about 12 or 13 international funds available right now in India from Indian mutual fund houses, which invest in what is called feeder funds. So these funds have tie-ups or they have their subsidiary funds abroad, which invest into Latin American countries, which invest into China, which invest into BRICS. So there is about a list of about 18 or 19 funds. I think 3 or 4 of them invest specifically into China is one easy way to do that. And we could email you if you wish the names of these funds, the China focused funds, for example. The other way that you could do that is to invest via, for example, a platform like PL Vested, which I just talked about, which allows you to invest in sector ETFs. Now, some of these sector ETFs or international ETFs are available on international platforms, and you could invest as little as, you know, even 100 rupees. So there are two ways to invest into such asset classes.
The next question is, should trading in derivatives be looked at from a short-term perspective? Can one do profitable business?
Yeah, so trading in derivatives, unless it's your profession. See, there are two kinds of people in the markets, right? There are people who are investing for the longer term. And like I said, from that perspective, I would consider trading in derivatives as absolutely a no-no. Unless that's your passion for some funny reason and you've limited the amount of exposure to a very minuscule portion, because derivatives by their nature are very, very leveraged short-term instruments and you want your portfolio to grow over the long term. When the nation is willing to offer you a 15 to 20% return by you just sitting at home and doing nothing except hoping that the regulators, the Prime Minister and the international economy allow Indian companies to fully realize their potential and make money for you. Why do you want to burn your hands investing in derivatives? That's from the long-term investor's point of view. From a trader's point of view, of course, derivatives are a very powerful instrument because obviously they are leveraged. So you can lose or make money almost overnight. I mean, yesterday I met somebody who said, you know, can you help me make money like my friend made? And I asked him what he did. He said something about, you know, he bought an option at 53 rupees on Bank Nifty and, you know, now he's made 20 lakhs out of a 1 lakh rupee investment. But then that requires you to commit to one, learning the instrument in depth, two, to understanding how the markets are going to behave and spend a lot of time understanding that. And three, watching markets constantly. If you are willing to commit time to all of this, derivatives are a very, very exciting trading opportunity.
The next question is from Mr. Kalpesh Lakhani, that where can we find model portfolio on plindia.com?
Yeah, so it's available. So Amisha, I think, displayed the model portfolio, the latest model portfolio. It's available in the research section at the Prabhudas Lilladher website, plindia.com. If you go into latest research and thematic, you'll find our latest reports there. It's called the India Strategy Report. And typically the 8th or 9th page would have the model portfolio.
Okay, next question is, when market is high as of now, is it good to redeem and reinvest SIP at a lower point or continue the SIP?
So like I said, you know, it's happening at the right time. You know, we are all scared and markets may indeed drop and we don't know. I mean, markets were expected to drop when they were at 10,000 levels, because I remember people saying 5,000. They were expected to then drop at 13,000 levels because we said COVID is returning with a bang. It's COVID 2. The Prime Minister is going to be on television anytime soon. Again, locking down the entire country. Sorry, but markets went to 15,000. Now we are talking about the US dollar reversing. So like I, you know, spent 45 minutes explaining, there are great opportunities available. When you are investing for the long term, you are not investing in a speculative instrument called the market. You're investing in great companies. You're becoming a shareholder of some great companies. And as a shareholder, like a parent, you don't take a decision on your child every 6 months on whether he should be in school or should be playing sports or actually, you know, should be out of school. Similarly, when you buy a great company, hold it till it completes at least a couple of cycles of profitability and challenges, which is typically a 5 to 7 year period. So when you're buying into stocks, do not worry about indices. The question right now is not whether I should be paring down my exposure. Of course, you should pare down your exposure if you're overly exposed. But then if you've not bought into great stories, and some of these stories are available in our model portfolio, then you should be buying them tomorrow morning, irrespective of what happens to the Nifty over the next few days.
Correct. Next question is, can we directly trade in shares of Chinese company instead of mutual fund?
No, you can buy into shares, not Chinese companies for sure, because China is not yet a party to the agreement with SEBI and RBI in India. You could buy ETFs which are dedicated to China. No trading is allowed internationally, right? So Indians are not allowed to use their LES facility for trading. It is for investing. And that investing class is limited to certain assets, 6 or 7 assets as per the LRS circular.
Okay. Next question is from Nirali Trivedi. Should we also diversify our portfolio in equity and mutual funds, or should it be only concentrated in equity? Can one be a good investor and a good trader?
Absolutely. So you just heard a lady speak for about 1.5 hours who, you know, not only does, you know, very good at trading somehow, and she also does very good at investing somehow. I've never understood how Amisha operates. You can be good at both, but like she said, it's not about finding the best ideas, finding the market bottoms. It's about finding a good idea, researching it, keeping discipline about where to book profits or where to book losses, not getting emotional about money, because once you've lost a lot of money, it's never going to come back, right? That money is gone. So it requires a lot of discipline. It requires you to, you know, be consciously engaged with people who know about these things. So if you're not going to be able to do all that, I would suggest you go through mutual funds. However, if you want to take, or if you have certain beliefs, then be definitely invested into stocks. And as you grow more experienced, increase your stock exposure directly or indirectly via things like portfolio management services, and decrease your mutual fund exposure because they tend to be over diversified. But if you're beginning your stock market journey, mutual funds should be dominating your portfolio, followed by stocks, large cap stocks typically. And as you grow older, it should be exactly the opposite.
Okay. Next question is from Sagar Parmar. What is the time when we should switch or change portfolio allocation?
So, okay. So like I said, the important principle in doing all of this is to every quarter, you know, sit down and study your portfolio. So let's say, for example, you had put 70 rupees in equities and let's say 30 rupees in other asset classes. And without getting emotional about how you got there, look at whether your portfolio has suddenly become 80 or 85% equities. If at the end of the quarter that has happened, then sit down and pare back some of this 15 rupees and put it into asset classes which have not performed. This is called quarterly rebalancing, right? So whether you do it every quarter, you do it every month, I think a month is too often because it has also tax implications. 6 months may be too late because asset classes can deteriorate very badly. Therefore, we suggest a quarterly rebalancing decision based on first your asset class exposure. So for example, let's say gold went from 10 to 15% of your portfolio, you know, remove that extra 5% because that's extra. But on the other hand, suppose income funds did not perform, put that 5 rupees into income funds, you know, things like that. So that's an asset allocation rebalancing. At the individual instrument level, you can always take a decision. So for example, when 70 went to 85, maybe, you know, you bought into, I don't know, Hindustan Lever and that's doubled. So you might want to reduce the exposure like that by selling some of the Hindustan Lever stock.
Right. Next question is from Kaushal Shah. Is it better to invest in short-term debt fund and in banking and PSU mutual fund over bank FD to earn more return for horizon of 1 year?
If you had invested 1 year ago into the bank Nifty, your portfolio, even when the Nifty went down by about 30%, the bank Nifty collapsed by almost 70%. Right? So when you're taking an individual sector exposure or individual stock exposure, for example, banking or PSU banks and so on and so forth, from an investing point of view, of course you should invest, but then that's a different discussion. If you're asking me whether PSU banks from a stock market point of view are likely to do well, yes, they're likely to do extremely well for a wide variety of reasons, including the fact that the recent budget now starts talking about things like privatization instead of words like, divestment. So that essentially, and with, yields remaining soft for a long period of time, credit pickup, et cetera, the PSU banks are likely to be the biggest beneficiaries. Short term, if you want to invest in line with your risk appetite and your trading pattern, of course, you can go ahead and invest. From a long term point of view, I would still repeat the same thing. That should be only part of your overall portfolio.
Okay. So the next question is, at what time to exit from SIP if no goal is decided?
The exit from SIPs has to be only either when you retire or when there is a sudden emergency and you need the money. I would suggest that once you've started the SIP journey, do not stop till you can afford it. And at any point of time, unfortunately, day before yesterday, I think there was an article, Indians, 60-70% of Indians still redeem their SIPs within 3 years. This is the biggest mistake. I know I'm saying the wrong thing because maybe a couple of you might not redeem their SIPs. And then over the next 1 month, if the Nifty comes down, you'll be abusing me. Luckily, I won't be on Zoom then. But the fact of the matter is, that is exactly the painful periods is what creates the magic of SIPs, because it is the painful periods when you end up buying a lot more with your investing. So if you are willing to take the pain, if you have the time horizon on your side, do not stop your SIPs and definitely don't give less than 10 years to any SIP or till the age of retirement or there's an emergency.
Okay. The last question for the session is, what is the framework to decide about making changes in portfolio allocation?
Yeah, so the framework essentially, there's a lot of ways you can do it. You can talk to us, but like I said, the 100 minus age principle is what you need to be looking at. So for example, if you've got time on your side or you've got lots of money and you're not worried, you would be something what we refer to as an aggressive customer. Now, an aggressive customer would typically be 80% into high risk return instruments, about 20% into contingency cash as well as mutual funds. If you're a conservative investor, now you could be conservative either because your retirement is very close or your liquidity is not very good, or you're not sure about being able to take risk, then you would typically be the opposite, which means about 70 to 80% of your money would typically, long-term money would be typically into, safe asset classes and only about 10 or 20% in equities. If you're an average 40-year-old or plus or minus 5 years, then it would be ideal if you're 50-50. I would suggest that at least a 50-50 allocation for everybody who's less than 50 years of old age, unless you have some pressing emergency, should be the minimum for an Indian if you have a 5 to 10 year horizon. Once you've decided that, then the question is about what makes you comfortable. So, as you start investing with a conscious philosophy, and I'm not joking, but one of my first investors when I started my career started with a 50,000 rupee investment with a focus on asset allocation and grew to be one of my largest investors. I remember on the day, because he decided to take his money and invest in his own company, and this was 10 years later. I'm not joking, but 10 years later, he asked me, Sandeep, I'm going to be now 70% debt and only 10% equity. You told me 10 years ago that I have to be 80% equity. Is that all right? And I was so happy because he had lived by that principle his entire life. And that essentially is a decision you'll come to grips with as you start investing with this core philosophy in your mind.
Okay, so the questions are over. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for this.
My pleasure and honor.
And it is indeed a matter of proud for us to have you on this platform. And thank you for sharing your insights.
Thank you so much for having me over. Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.